The verses, which are supposed to refer to a specifically threefold deity, are particularly weak as proofs aimed at someone who is not already a Christian. Usually, the argument is simply based on the fact that terms for God appear three times in the verse, and this is just not a persuasive reason for accepting as strange and difficult a doctrine as the Trinity. Well, needless to say, there are many more verses where terms for God appear only twice, a few verses where they appear more than three times, and an overwhelming majority where such a term appears just once. The most commonly cited verse of this sort is a very well-known one, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." This is from Deuteronomy 6, verse 4. Now, the point is supposed to be that the threefold deity, the Lord our God, the Lord, is really one. In fact, however, this is a mistranslation, since Hebrew omits the present tense of the verb to be. Even the word is in the Lord is one does not appear in the Hebrew. So the correct translation is, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one." Here, the Trinitarian interpretation can't even get started. But the main point is that this type of evidence from threefold repetition is significant only for someone who already believes. The verses said to demonstrate plurality within God that deserve serious attention are supposed to demonstrate such plurality without pointing to a specific number. The passage quoted most frequently to prove this is Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, where God, speaking at the climactic moment in the process of creation, says, "Let us make man in our image." Now, the Bible almost always uses singular verbs in referring to God, and the plural here really does require explanation. But almost any explanation is superior to the view that the Bible has chosen this verse to teach us the doctrine of the Trinity. The verb may be plural of majesty, such as, the royal we, or a plural of self-exhortation, as in the English, "let's go," even when someone's talking to himself, or an indication that God was consulting the angels at this critical point of creation. Some Jews have even suggested that God was including the earth in the task of creating man, since it would supply the body while he would supply the soul. It's worth noting that the earth and water were commanded to bring forth other living things. Every one of these interpretations explains very naturally why the plural verb is used here and not earlier or later in the chapter. Only the Trinitarian interpretation fails to do this. Another verse often cited to demonstrate plurality within God is Psalm 110, verse 1. "The Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies my footstool." Now, the Christian view would have us hold that the second Lord should also be capitalized, and that one divine being, that is the Father, was speaking to the other divine being, the Son. But it's far more likely, however, that the author of the psalm is writing a dialogue between God and the author's Lord, i.e. King David, the king. Thus, "the Lord said to the author's Lord," the king, "sit at my right hand," in other words, under my protection. "To David" is the heading of the psalm, which means dedicated to David and not by David. The verse then refers to one divine Lord and one human Lord and has absolutely no reference to plurality within God.